Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be the kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord has made known his victory.
God's righteousness
shall God judge the world.
And all the peoples in peace and equity.
O Lord, how manifold are your works. From the altar. Get it from the altar. Let us pray. Jesus, light of the world, John the Baptist spoke of you as the one who is to come. Come to us, make us good, make us ready to welcome you at Christmas time. Amen. Zion, your Christ is drawing near. Let every hill and valley a level way appear. Greet one who comes in glory, foretold in sacred Christ who came in God's own holy name. He brings God's rule, O Zion. He comes from heaven above. His rule is peace and freedom, and justice, truth, and love. Lift high your praise resounding, for Christ and joy abounding. Oh, blessed is Christ that came in God's most holy name. Fling wide your gates, O Zion, your Savior's rule embrace. His tidings of salvation proclaim in every place. All lands will bow before him, their voices will adore him. Oh, blessed is Christ that came in God's most holy name. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Merciful God, who sent your messengers, the prophets, to preach repentance and prepare the way for our salvation, give us grace to heed their warnings and forsake our sins, that we may greet with joy the coming of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You have been gracious to your land, O Lord. You have forgiven the iniquity of your people
and blotted out all their sins.
I will listen to what the Lord God is saying.
For he is speaking peace to his faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to him.
Truly his salvation is very near to those who fear him.
That his glory may dwell in our land.
Mercy and truth have met together.
Righteousness and peace.
Truth shall spring up from the earth,
and righteousness shall look down from heaven.
The Lord will indeed grant prosperity,
and our land will yield its increase.
Righteousness shall go before him,
and peace shall be a pathway for his feet.
A reading from the second letter of Peter to the Corinthians. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of the God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and the elements will melt with fire. But in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
bank the Baptist's cry announces that the Lord is nigh. Awake and hearken, for he brings the tidings of the King of Kings. Then cleanse thee every heart from sin. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Advent doth thy people free, whom with the Father we adore, and Holy Spirit evermore. Please be seated. The people had been taken into exile in Babylon by Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians. And as they were rounding up the various people, they made sure that they took the best educated, the brightest, the youngest, and those who are able to be of some service to them, and left the old and the sick behind. And then, to just sort of add insult to injury, Nebuchadnezzar had the temple looted and then destroyed. So that temple built by Solomon was in ruins. And those who were left behind could weep and mourn about that, but the rest were too busy being dragged off into exile where they would be for about 70 years. As the history wore on, the Medes and the Persians were gathering strength and force, and eventually they invade Babylon. Oh, for goodness sake. I'm sorry. My phone is ringing here.
Oh, that's your phone?
That's my phone.
Nice.
I thought I turned it off. Oh, well. Just have to wait. Anyhow, I'll talk over it. And good, it stopped.
Rob's talking.
These things give away too many secrets.
It does both by the mic.
What?
It does both by the mic.
That's my phone, yes.
No, it says it rings and then it talks.
Yeah, then it talks to me.
Nice. Mine just rings.
Now, if I could pick up my train of thought again.
The Persians were gathering strength.
The Medes and the Persians were gathering strength. Thank you. You know what I want to say next? And so, as that's going on to their west, the prophet Isaiah begins his ministry with the people in exile. And the scholars tell us that these chapters between 40 and 55 in the prophecy of Isaiah come from that period. And what's happening there is that they are being reminded that indeed Yahweh, who was unhappy with you, was angry with you because of your unfaithfulness to him and your unfaithfulness to the covenant, and because of all the things that you had done that made the life of the poor and the lesser ones so awful, even though you'd done all of these things, God now was going to give you a gift. And first of all, the gift was the reminder of the love that God had for them. And so the prophet begins these words today where he says, you know, comfort, oh comfort my people, speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. And they are told that there's going to be this one who is going to be the voice that's raised up, that's going to remind them that yes, indeed, there is a liberation coming. There is a return that's going to be coming. And that the way for the Lord who is going to make this happen has to be prepared. And what that meant for them was they needed to regroup and reform. They needed to regroup themselves as people of God. They needed to reform their lives. They needed to repent of those things that got them dragged off into exile in the first place. And they needed to concentrate again on what it meant to be people of the covenant. And we have to remember that they are there in exile about 70 years. And so the older ones among them may have been now very old, or perhaps would have died. There would have been some that were born in captivity and had never been in the promised land before, but might have only heard about it. And then there were the other ones who were young when they were taken off into exile. And so they were, in a sense, called to relearn what it meant to be this people chosen by God, what it meant to have their own land, and what it meant for them to now have a renewed relationship that God wanted to have with them in order to bring them back to their land and make them again into the people that he had called them to be in the first place. And he uses the shepherd image there towards the end, saying that now this great shepherd of the sheep, which was a very common and important image for them, is going to be guiding them and guiding the mother sheep as well, so that they would all eventually get back to the land, even though it's going to take time for that process to play out. Because the invasion didn't happen overnight, and things didn't fall into place just overnight. But in the course of time, with this encouragement, this reminder of the love and the faithfulness of Yahweh to his own people, that it would come to pass. So there's a certain patience that the people are being asked to exercise, even though the patience of Yahweh, who could very well have just wiped out this disobedient, disagreeable, and recalcitrant people. But he doesn't do that. He stays with them, even in the midst of their suffering, and reminding them that this is not all there is to the picture. And Paul in the second lesson, Peter in the second lesson, and I apologize for the typo. There is no such thing as second letter of Peter to the Corinthians, but just the second letter of Peter. And Peter is reminding his early Christian community that while they're waiting for the second coming of Christ, because they really did expect it to come sooner than later, they needed to take a cue from God's patience with them. And that as they were being patient in turn, that they would be willing to repent of anything that they had done that would put them on the outs with God. If they in any way had embraced sin that they had left behind before, if they had in any way begun to seriously doubt that the Lord was going to return, that it was time for them to understand that the reason that the Lord was giving time for this was that they would have ample time to reflect, to pray, and to repent, so that they could, and then when the day came, fully embrace the return of the great one who had loved them and called them into this relationship through baptism and grace, so that they would be able then to fully share in his life. And that's what leads us into the gospel. You know, John the Baptist figures in each of the four gospels. In Mark's gospel, he does things really, really quickly. We don't hear what he has to say to those who come to the river, as we hear in Matthew and also in Luke. But John the Baptist is there fulfilling this mission to be, as it says in Isaiah, the voice crying in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. Calling the people to know that God is going to act soon in your midst. And so your repentance is going to smooth his way into your own lives and into the lives of the people. So they were being readied for the coming of the Messiah. He was letting them know that indeed He's in our midst, but we're not ready to recognize him yet. He hasn't made himself known. But the problem was going to be that some of those people who repented would reject Jesus when he would come. Some of those who would reject him were those whose conversion was not really sincere. Recall that in one of the other Gospels, or Matthew at least, or perhaps also in Luke, when the Pharisees and those of their party come to the river to be baptized by John, he calls them a brood of vipers. He calls them a bunch of snakes. Who told you to flee from the wrath to come? You know, you got to give some evidence of your repentance. But you need to be truly reconciled to Yahweh. You need to really be sorry for what you've done so that the Lord's way can be prepared into your heart, let alone into the midst of this people that you so negatively many times influence. And so, this second Sunday of Advent switches from looking at the second coming of Christ more towards his time of ministry before his first coming. But now he's in the midst of his people, and what is it that he wants from them? He's going to call them to repentance just like John did, but he's going to call them to a further repentance of letting go of all of the ways of the past that stood in the way of their becoming fully alive in God the way God intended it to be for his people. And that would mean turning away from the strictures of the law. And Jesus never says that the law is evil in and of itself. But he does say that, you know, the law is only a guide. It's not God. And the Pharisees had kind of made it into God, complete with 613 commandments of how you were supposed to fulfill it, which no one could faithfully and successfully fulfill, not even the Pharisees themselves. And so people were getting farther and farther away from Yahweh, distancing themselves, and not just the sinners, the, you know, like the tax collectors and the prostitutes and the thieves and all the rest, but it was the ordinary people who tried every day to live up to what they were called to do, who were failing at it and became discouraged and maybe just drifted away. They were lost. And the Pharisees many times underscored that for them. Yeah, you are lost. Yesterday, I gave at their Advent quiet day. I was only supposed to give one talk, but the rector there had earlier in the week come down with COVID. And so even though he was over it enough to participate yesterday, he didn't want to, you know, take any chances with, you know, overstressing his voice. So I gave the talks. But they were on the four last things: death, judgment, heaven, and hell. Something we don't talk often about in our time, but yet, back into the early Middle Ages, and in fact for many centuries, Advent was a time when those themes were looked at in preparation for welcoming Christ at Christmas, was welcoming the idea, well, it was welcoming the opportunity to reflect on those great mysteries of our life as Christians, as disciples, and how we're going to face the mystery of our own death And how do we look at the judgment that God is going to make on us? And then, are we really concerned about our final destination? Do we really want to live in the fullness of life with God in heaven? Or do we not really worry too much about it, or don't think that it's all it's cracked up to be? And so we don't bother with any of it, or we say, well, there is no hell, so I don't have anything to worry about. Well, when Jesus comes on the scene after John has done his ministry, he makes it very plain that the reason that he has come is to redeem the human race. He makes it very plain that he is here to deliver us ultimately from the power of sin and suffering and death, and that we have to be reminded from time to time, no matter how young or how old we are, that someday this life as we know it is going to come to an end. It's not something we like to think about. It's something we kind of know up here, but it takes longer time to feel it down here or to accept it. But yet, it is the reality that we have to face. And then, at that moment, when we die, we are going to be judged immediately. And our time of repentance is over with. There's no more repenting after death. There's no more saying, oh, give me another chance, Lord. You know, I'll do it better this time. You know, there's no reincarnation. There is nothing like that. This life, and to be crass about it, is a one-shot deal. We live it, and hopefully we will live it with the Lord, aware that even though we are His, we still fall short, we still sin, we still make mistakes that influence the life of other people, and not just our own. I said this morning at 8 o'clock that when I came into church here this morning, you know, a little after 7, I turned on the lights, and then I noticed that something wasn't quite right around the altar. And all of a sudden, my anger flared, and I slammed my hand down on the altar. And as soon as I did that, I said, oops, sorry, Lord, didn't mean to do that. And then I mumbled a few things to myself about my behavior. But the thing was, it was a reminder to me that anger is something that I have to continue to deal with. And that the sinful side of that is sometimes how I may respond to another person or talk about a group of people or even behave in front of others. And even in that case, in front of the Lord, here I am, losing my temper over something totally stupid, but nevertheless, a reminder, never mind what it was. I'll tell you later.
You can't hear me when I talk.
Michelle, let me go on.
Sorry.
Anyway, so it was just a very poignant reminder to me that no matter where I think I am on the life's journey, that there is still repenting that I need to do. Something that will figure into the judgment that God would enact on me if I would die right now. And then, since there is no more time to repent, and there is no second chance, where would my final destination be? And so that's the kind of thing that
is a sobering thought as we move through this time of the year where we are preparing for Christmas, maybe for travel, maybe for receiving guests, what we're going to eat, how we're going to, where we're going to go to celebrate, etc., etc. Somebody's going to bring you something, Michelle. But as we're going through all those other preparations, we can lose sight of the importance of preparing ourselves, looking to our own lives and our need to hear the Lord saying to us, repent, believe in the good news, change the direction of your life, let go of the things that stand in the way, that make it difficult for you to deal with others, and difficult at times to deal with the Lord Himself. But that we take seriously that preparation. And that's what John the Baptist can remind us of. That he calls us to a change of heart in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. And you know, Jesus didn't just come once in the past. And he's not just coming once in the future. But he's coming to us once again today. In the here and now. Through his word. Through each of us who believe. And in the gift of himself in Holy Communion. Where he comes to us. That Lord who calls us by name. Calls us to repent. Is truly the good shepherd. Who's going to lead us to where we need to be if we let him. He's not going to force us, but wants to invite us to walk the way with him so that we can also grow into the people that he has created us and called us to be, so that that gift of that we received in our baptism can continue to bear fruit and to grow until that moment when we have the opportunity to meet the Lord face to face. We thank the one who tears open the heavens and comes down to meet us, who draws us into himself, even as he gives himself to us, so that we can be what he wants us to be and knows we can be, and what will be the best for us. Now let us stand to profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. Oh, for goodness sake. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten for all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again to judge the world, to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets.
And I believe one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us lift up our voices to God in the strength God bestows.
We, your church, long to see your face. Speak to us, Lord, as we listen for the sound of your voice. Give our leaders patience, wisdom, and a heart for your will, especially Justin of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Paula, our bishop, and Mike, our rector. Strengthen them as they reach out to you in prayer and hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear us as we pray.
We pray for our leaders, especially Joseph, our president, J.B. Pritzker, our governor, the Congress and courts of this land. Guide the leaders of the nations as they work for the welfare of their people and the good of all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear us as we pray.
Awaken us to the suffering of people near us and those far from us, especially those affected by warfare in Israel and Gaza and Ukraine, or civil unrest in Pakistan, Somalia, Yemen, South Sudan, Venezuela, and Nicaragua. Equip us to respond to their needs. Arouse in us a sense of urgency to demonstrate your good news in our lives and voice it that all may hear. We ask your blessing on those who struggle with illness, anxiety, grief, or isolation, especially those on our intercessory prayer list, or who are listed in today's bulletin, or in the intention books, and those we mention now.
Annette.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear us as we pray.
Father of us all, we pray for those who celebrate birthdays or anniversaries this week, especially Roger Volkman. Are there others? Are there any wedding anniversaries? And we ask you to comfort those who have lost hope, who struggle with anxiety about the future, who live in fear. Bring healing to those for whom we now pray. We pray for James D. Remigio and all those who have died. That their memories be blessings in our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear us as we pray.
O Lord, we remember before you the United Church of Pakistan, their primate, bishops, people, and clergy, in the Diocese of Chicago, the organizations of Episcopal Charities and Community Services, especially Ravenswood Community Services, Shelter Care Ministries, Holy Family School, St. Leonard's Ministries, Hopeful Beginnings, Youth Guidance, Waukegan to College, and extend your compassionate hand towards the ministries and organizations of our companion dioceses of Southeast Mexico and Rank South Sudan. Lord, in your mercy,
hear us as we pray. Let us now offer the prayer for the mission of our parish found inside the front cover of the bulletin. Loving God, through your grace, guide us, the Calvary Episcopal Church, to joyfully carry out our mission of growing faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, that we may develop a living faith that deepens our understanding of you and strengthens our awareness of the needs of others. May we be a transforming light within our parish and within the community. All this we ask in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us now confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Peace. Thank you, Michelle. Peace, peace. Peace.
Peace, Father mine.
Peace, Sherry. Thank you. Please be seated. In your pews, you've probably noticed these Christmas flower envelopes. If you are intending to donate some money in memory or in honor of someone, please, you know, you can use those. Or there is a second site that's been set up in the Memorial Hall near where you sign up for flowers. There is a separate binder there where you can write your intention for your flowers in there, and there are envelopes there as well. So either you can use one from the church if you wish, or you can do it out there in the Memorial Hall, and then we'll just make sure that that all is done and processed and will be in the bulletin for Christmas. Next Sunday is the third Sunday of the month, and it's the Sunday when we have the open plate for the rector's discretionary fund, so I just would ask you to keep that in mind. Also, on Christmas Day, we will have another of the community dinners. So anyone who does not have a place to be on Christmas Day, you are welcome to come and share that time and meal with others here at the church following the 10:30 service on Christmas Day. excuse me. And there is a sign-up sheet for that online, but also outside the kitchen on the bulletin board, where you can sign up for how many of you might be coming and what you might be bringing. Or if you want to bring something for others but wouldn't be taking the part in the meal yourself, you can note that on that list as well. stewardship letters, for those who do not receive email, went out this week, as well as the electronic version went out online. So we're asking you, first of all, I want to apologize that it took so long for us to get that out, but just the nature of things lately. So we would ask you to prayerfully consider what you're going to do to pledge for the parish for the next year, and then to return your pledge form as soon as reasonably possible
either via email or mailing it in or dropping it in the collection or however you would choose to inform the office. But we'd like to have that within the next week so that we then can prepare the preliminary budget with more knowledge about what we will have to deal with. down across from the kitchen, on the cabinet that has various kinds of literature, you will also find these church calendars. They have Calvary's particular information at the top, but the calendar itself is about the entire church year, the various memorials of saints and feasts and fasts and other kind of information that you might be interested in. If you want to make a donation for the calendar, you can, but you don't have to. There are probably around 20 of them down across from the kitchen right now. And we have 25 more in the office because we can only order if we want anything printed on it. So please keep that in mind. This afternoon at 4:30, down at the Peg Bond Center, the Songs and Lights, a celebration sponsored by the Batavia Ministerial Association, the participation of several clergy and all the community together and do something, sing a few songs, hear a message, and just have some time to associate with each other before getting into the more hectic days of Christmas. And there will be hot cider and popcorn there for free. And also, there should be some food trucks there. And if it follows the pattern of last year, which I think it will, that food also will be free of charge. There will be an opportunity to make an offering that will go to one of the charitable organizations that the Ministerial Association support. So that's this afternoon. excuse me. And then there are other messages in the bulletin that I would just call to your attention. Anything else? Anybody via Zoom? Terry?
I would like to ask for help with the coffee hour. Sign up for December 24th, and that's Christmas Eve, and the following week is New Year's Eve. It would be nice if we could have maybe two people or three people sign up for those coffee hours, because I believe they're going to be quite, we'll have a, hopefully have a lot of people on those days. Thanks.
And just a reminder that on Christmas Eve morning, the 24th, we will be observing the fourth Sunday of Advent, and so we'll have the 8 and 10:15 that morning, and then the Christmas services begin at 5 p.m. With the family Eucharist and with the way whatever the children will be doing under the direction of Ross for the Liturgy of the Word. And then at 7 p.m., we have the Christ Mass with the assistance of our organist and if Bill's available for supporting our singing, as well as we will have a trumpeter here again for our service. And then on Christmas Day, the 25th, we will have an 8 o'clock service. Will be right one service, and then 10:30 service, it'll be right two. If you will then turn in your bulletins to the offertory prayer. I also do want to apologize for a couple of the kind of unprofessional moments this morning, and also apologize for some of the errors in the bulletin that when I proofread, I obviously overlooked. So the offertory prayer, Lord, accept our praises, have compassion on our human frailty, and since we have nothing of ourselves to offer, let your mercy make us acceptable in your sight through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth through Jesus Christ our Lord. You led your people to Christ by the preaching of John the Baptist, his friend and forerunner. In the desert, John prepared his way and announced the presence of your Son, promising his righteous judgment and his gifts of truth and grace. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. God of power and might.
kneel or be seated. Glory and thanksgiving be to you, most loving Father. In Jesus you show to us yourself. Our hope is built on him, the first, the last, the living one, obedient even to accepting death. He opened the gate of glory and calls us now to share the life of heaven. Before he was given up to suffering and death, alight with the vision of a feast that heralded a kingdom yet to come, at supper with his disciples he took bread and offered you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body. It is broken for you." After supper, he took the cup. He offered you thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It is poured out for you and for the many, that sins may be forgiven. Do this in remembrance of me." Therefore we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Father, we recall your Son's command, his blessed passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and we look for the coming of his kingdom. Made one with him, we offer you these gifts, and with them ourselves, a single, holy, living sacrifice. Hear us, most merciful Father, and send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and this wine that, overshadowed by his life-giving power, they may be the body and blood of your Son, and we may be kindled with the fire of your love and renewed for the service of your kingdom. Help us, who are baptized into the fellowship of Christ's body, to live and work to your praise and glory. May we grow together in unity and love until at last in your new creation we enter into our heritage in the company of the Virgin Mary, the apostles, prophets, blessed Thomas Merton, blessed Karl Barth, and of all our brothers and sisters living and departed. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be to you, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer, Redeemer of us.
Blessed Jesus, with the Christian faithful across the world, gathered at every altar of your church, where your blessed body and blood are offered this day, I long to offer you praise and thanksgiving for creation and all the blessings of this life, for the redemption won for us by your life, death, and resurrection, for the means of grace and the hope of glory, and particularly for the blessings given me. I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament, and since I cannot at this time receive communion, I pray you to come into my heart. I unite myself with you and embrace you with all my heart, my soul, and my strength, mind. Let nothing separate me from you. Let me serve you in this life until by your grace I come to your glorious kingdom in unending peace. Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in my heart in the fullness of your strength. Be my wisdom and guide me in right pathways. Conform my life and actions to the image of your holiness. And in the power of your gracious might, rule over every hostile power that threatens or disturbs the growth of your kingdom, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. A reminder, again, if you want to receive communion with the little cup, just extend one hand when you approach. If you wish to receive communion in the standard way, just put your right hand over your left as you approach for Holy Communion. And then if you wish to receive from the chalice, you can do so. And Jessica will be administering the chalice down floor level in front of the lectern. And we do remind all of our visitors that in the Episcopal Church, all baptized Christians who receive Holy Communion in your own church are welcome to receive communion here. Christ, the bread of heaven.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, come upon you, mercy and glory be to you.
Shines through all our hopes and prayers and dreams. Guide us to justice, truth, and love, delivered from our selfish schemes. May swords of hate fall from our hands, our hearts from end. Find release till by God's grace our warring world shall see Christ's promise of peace. Then shall the wolf dwell with the lamb, nor shall the fierce devour the small, as beasts and cattle. Calmly grace, a little child shall lead them all. Then enemies shall learn to love, all creatures find their true accord. The hope of peace shall be fulfilled, for all the earth shall know the Lord. The prayer after Holy Communion. Let us pray. Filled with the food which nourishes the Spirit, we pray to you, Lord, grant us wisdom to live in this passing age and inspire us with longing for the age to come, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
I just want to express a belated welcome to our visitors who are with us today, and invite you to share fellowship with us following the service. Just follow the crowd out this way and then down the long hallway to the right. May Almighty God, by whose providence our Savior Christ came among us in great humility, sanctify you with the light of his blessing and set you free from all sin. Coming in power and great glory we await, make you steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and constant in love.
Amen. Amen.
May you who rejoice in the first advent of our Redeemer at his second advent be rewarded with unending life.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.